Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of the Venom Vlog. And today we are going to talk about Sins Rising, parts 1 through 4. So that's basically Spider-Man, or Amazing Spider-Man. I think it's issues 44, maybe, or 45, 46. No, 45, 46, 47, 48. So those four issues. That's what we're going to go over today, because there is a conclusion to the story that just came out this week. And we'll get to that after I, you know, read it and digest it and kind of process it, because it looks like it's a big book. It's like a $10 book. So and then there's also a one shot called The Sins of Norman Osborn that will also be covered in the next episode with that giant issue 850 slash issue 49. So today it's just going to be 45 through 48. And the we have Nick Spencer obviously writing this book, and we have Mark Bagley doing the art, and also Marcelo Ferreira. But I think one of the issues said Marcelo was the artist, and it definitely looked like Bagley's artwork. So I don't know if Marcelo is like a pupil of his, or a student of his, or someone who just, you know, is very close to his style. But I was kind of thrown off by that in one of the issues. I think they were like, Marcelo drew this, and I was flipping through it. I'm like, this seems like Bagley, but I don't know, maybe it's just so similar that my brain can't tell the difference, which is entirely possible. But either way, the look of all four of these issues is awesome. And I do like that Bagley did come back and at least definitively drew one of the issues. I don't know if he came in and did stuff on the other ones or not, but he definitely did the first part here, which is issue 45 of Amazing Spider-Man. And if you haven't been reading Nick Spencer's run, I gotta say, it is actually a really good book. The only thing I don't like about it is actually this big mystery he's building on this character called Kindred. Kindred, someone who showed up early on, has like centipedes and stuff crawling all over them. And I say them because we don't know if it's a guy or a girl. They have like a hood on, but they look like a skeleton or a mummy underneath. They apparently have the ability to walk right into hell and resurrect characters like the Sin Eater and bring them back to the world of the living. So definitely super powerful. I'm sure we'll find out who that person is either in issue 850 or soon afterwards, because I think there's another story coming out after Sins Rising that focuses more on Kindred and kind of, you know, maybe Kindred's identity or something. So I don't know. We'll get there when we get there. But that stuff I actually find the least interesting. The Kindred stuff has definitely felt like it's been dragged out, and it feels like it's something that could have been revealed earlier on, at least to the audience, and then maybe it's something, you know, we're screaming at the page to tell Peter Parker, like, come on, dude, figure it out, figure it out. I think that could have been a much more interesting approach than what Nick's doing. This hiding who they are thing is, it's built up so long now, almost 50 issues, that it's kind of getting to the point now where when they reveal whoever Kindred is, if it's not really good, it's going to really, like, sully a lot of, you know, people's perspective on this book. Like, I still think the best book Marvel puts out right now is Daredevil by Chip Zdarsky. I think that's consistently the best Marvel book that's out there. But this actually is a lot of fun, and it's nice to read fun Spider-Man stories again. So besides the Kindred stuff, I'm loving everything else. So I do love that Sin Eater's back. We talked about that in the last episode where we talked, you know, Spider-Man stuff, where Stan Carter, the original Sin Eater, has been brought back by Kindred somehow. And we're going to, you know, hopefully learn that at some point. But either way, Kindred went into hell and found Stan Carter's soul and resurrected it, brought him to the land of living, gave him a new shotgun, you know, decked him out in his old costume. And now whenever he goes around and he shoots people, they don't stay dead. And we find that out in this issue. We find out that Overdrive, in the first part of the story, Peter had a nightmare sequence, you know, a couple episodes ago when we talked about that in issue 44, the prequel, the prelude setting up this. We talked about how Spider-Man had this nightmare that Overdrive was in it and that Overdrive might die. So that's what happens in this book. It basically starts off and you have Carly Cooper, I think. She was like someone who used to date Peter Parker during the Dan Slott run. And she's like a forensic person or something. So I thought that was cool that they kind of brought her back. And now she's working at a morgue. And she has the body of Overdrive. And she's examining the body. And I was like, oh, that's cool that they brought Carly back. They also bring Nora Winters back, who's another character from the Dan Slott run, who was dating Philip Urich. Like, she was like this young lady who was working at the Daily Bugle, and she wanted to be a journalist, and she was like, you know, willing to cut corners and like even sacrifice at one point almost her own boyfriend to get a story or get a scoop. And she's like a pretty weird character, but I'm glad they kind of brought her back, because she has a couple moments where she comes into Ravencroft and she wants to interview Norman Osborn, because obviously he's in charge of Ravencroft now. And why that is, again, we haven't really gotten into that yet on the Venom vlog, but I will do a Ravencroft week where we talk about the 3 one-shots and the 5-issue miniseries, and that's going to set up why Norman is exactly here. So if you're watching this later on my playlist of things that happen in order, hopefully all these are in order on the playlist. But if you're watching just randomly on the videos, they're all over the place here. So I try to make a playlist where I put all the storylines of the comic history in order. So that way, if you want to just start at the beginning of Venom and work your way through all the stuff that's going on now, and then I'll splice in some Spider-Man stuff here and there, like this episode. Hopefully you enjoy it and you can watch it in order that way. So we have Nora Winter. She's like interviewing, Norman Osborn, trying to understand what he's doing at Ravencroft, and how someone who was a patient there like 2 weeks ago is now the guy who's running it. And he admits hey, I wasn't myself. Carnage was in me. There was something going on. I wasn't in control of my body. And once I was cleared, by experts and stuff, they said I can resume, running a business, because I used to run my own business at Oscorp, and now I'm running Ravencroft. And we're going to find out, over time, I'm sure, that he's up to something for sure. Like, he's Norman Osborn. Of course he is. So in this, the story starts off and Peter is trying to help Overdrive. And he's like, okay, I saw him in my nightmare or my dream or whatever that was. And now this is happening in real life. So Peter's like saving the people around him, because Overdrive, obviously, like he said in the dream sequence, he was saying that he was driving, and every time he turned his shoulder over, he could see Sin Eater just somehow there magically. And then Sin Eater was just gaining on and gaining on. And he drove all the way from Mexico all the way to New York City. And he's trying to get, to safety, try to get to Spider-Man or somebody that can help him. And he gets there, he gets in New York City, and he's almost running over people because now he's tired. He's been up for a day or whatever driving. So Spider-Man is having to save all these pedestrians. And then at the last second, Sin Eater wrecks the car. And Overdrive flies out of the car, and Sin Eater walks right up with a shotgun to get him, and Spider-Man tries to stop him, but he's unsuccessful. And so Overdrive gets shot right in front of Spider-Man and seemingly dies. And Spider-Man's like, no, 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 no. And then Sin Eater's like, I'm not ready to hurt you yet, Spider-Man. I have more things I got to do. You're on my list, but you're just not, I'm not on, you're not next on my list. So I'm going to go away. So he kind of vanishes, leaving Spider-Man with Overdrive, turning him over to, the proper authorities in the hospital and stuff, or the ambulance that shows up. So that's how he ends up in the care of Nora Winters, of Carly Cooper. And Carly Cooper, at the end of the book, has, or the first part of the book anyway, issue 45, she has Overdrive's body. And she's doing the exam, and that's when he wakes up. And he's like, oh my God, where am I? What happened to me? And that's when we realize Sin Eater isn't actually killing people with this new gun he has that's empowered by whatever the heck Kindred helped him empower it with. It's not like a gun that just takes your life. It takes your sins. So when you get hit with this, all the sins you've ever had go into Sin Eater. But it turns out not only do your sins go into him, but so does your superpower. So now Sin Eater has the ability to be his own getaway driver if he wants. He can drive like Overdrive was able to. And so we learn that more in the second part when the Lethal Legion show up, which is a group of four, kind of goofy characters like Count Nefaria stuff. And he's, they all get cured one by one by Sin Eater, and Spider-Man is too late. Or he shows up and tries to stop Sin Eater. He shows up first fighting the Lethal Legion, and then Sin Eater shows up, takes them, a couple of them out, and then escapes again. And so Spider-Man is, again, unable to stop Sin Eater. Like, he's shooting these villains and taking their powers. And he learns that when he shows up at, Sin Eater's warehouse. He tracks him and he finds him, and he's like, all right, what are you doing here? And at this point, Sin Eater has minions now. He has people from New York that have decided to side with him, because after he took down the Lethal Legion, he did it in front of cameras. And he shot them, and it looked brutal, but then they started waking up, and he turns and explains, I'm taking their sins. And he's like, so I can free this city. I can actually save the city in a way Spider-Man never could. I will make all these evil people, after I shoot them, they lose their powers, and they lose their evil. So they'll just go back to being good people, which I guess they're trying to say everyone's deep down is good inside, which that's a very positive message. Nick Spencer, that's nice of you to think that. I doubt it's true for some characters like Norman Osborn and stuff, but that's very nice of you to have that kind of outlook on life, I guess, because it's very positive. It's like, I was surprised by that. I was like, oh, interesting. So everyone just kind of reverts to goodness, I guess, when they get their sins taken away. But I guess that's just the effect of your sins being purged, is that you feel bad about them. So when Nora Winters is at Ravencroft, she interviews Count Nefario, and he says, please tell my victims I'm sorry. I can never undo what I've done. I've taken away family members and people that other people love. And I, and so there's an impact here. And New York, some New Yorkers are seeing a positive in it. So they start willingly signing up to be part of Sin Eater's group. But you find out that they're a little brainwashed. They're kind of like being sold something that's not really true. So once they side with him, he imbues them all with his power to where they can be wounded and then they can not die. So if like someone like cut someone's hand off, the hand would grow back and stuff like that. Or just as an example, like they all seem like slightly superhuman now. And now that they're all with Stan, siding with him and Sin Eater, doing whatever Kindred really wants them to do, because we don't really know what the big picture is yet. But they're at this warehouse and they have this hideout, and Spider-Man shows up and he says, why are you doing this? And he's like, because this place needs to be cleansed. And Spider-Man's like, I'm sorry for what happened to you. I take responsibility, but this is too much. You can't go around, doing what you're doing. And he's like, because there has to be something else going on. It can't just be as simple as you freeing everybody. Like you came back from hell essentially. And that's that. There's, I don't know if I trust this, and you're seemingly brought back by Kindred. So I feel like there's more going on here than what I'm seeing. And it can't just be this simple. And he's right. I don't think it's going to be this simple either. So Spider-Man is trying to stop Stan with words. But when that doesn't work, and he starts to learn Stan's real plan, Stan wants to go and take someone down in New York that has the most sins, which I was surprised wasn't Kingpin. Kingpin has a lot of sins too, but definitely in the Spider-Man world, you have Norman Osborn and he's running Ravencroft. So at the end of one of the issues, you find out that Stan and the Sin Eater and his group, they're going to go after Norman. So now Spider-Man is put in this rock and hard place where he has to decide what to do. Does he save Norman? Or does he allow Norman to get shot with this mystical gun and, and his sins are taken away and then he becomes maybe a good person? That's kind of the dilemma that Peter's in. And so while he's thinking about that, after Sin Eater, beats him up again using the powers of the Lethal Legions, he just mops the floor with Spider-Man in front of all of his minions and knocks him down. Then you have, Carly Cooper reaching out to Peter going, hey, this guy came back from the dead. So Spider-Man goes and checks in on Overdrive and starts learning more about, okay, these victims aren't actually dying. And that's how he was able to use the Lethal Legion power on me, is because he's absorbing everyone's abilities that he shoots, and he's taking their sins and he's using that energy to spread into his minions to make them powerful. So he's like, something big is happening here. And this is definitely the works and machinations of Kindred, but I don't know what yet, and I got to figure it out. And so until then, I got to just postpone what Stan wants to do. Stan wants to kill Norman Osborn or shoot him with the gun and, free him from his sins. And if that's what he wants to do, that means that's what Kindred wants him to do. And if Kindred wants him to do it, that means it's part of Kindred's plan. So I got to go stop it. I definitely got to at least postpone it or do something until we come up with a solution or figure out what that plan that Kindred has is. So that's what Spider-Man's doing. And meanwhile, he talks to Miles, and Miles is like, look, man, I've met a Norman Osborn and he killed you in my reality. Which is funny because I'm like, didn't all the realities blend together after Secret Wars? But I guess they're trying to now define it not so much. So I'm like, all right. So I thought Jonathan Hickman was like this big guy that everyone loves at Marvel, that he's like, he's going to shape, he shaped the Avengers and now he's going to shape the X-Men. And before that was Fantastic Four. But yet they seem to be retconning some of his stuff already. But I like that. I like that Miles remembers that he's from another universe. He should remember that. And maybe that's always been the case. Maybe Jonathan Hickman kept his memories. I can't remember because I haven't really read a lot of the Miles Morales stuff. So it's possible that I don't know what I'm talking about. But I do like that Miles remembers the Ultimate Universe. And he says, Peter, you were killed in front of a lot of people by Norman Osborn. And I've been having this dream that that's going to happen in this reality. And Spider-Man's like, yeah, okay, I don't care. Norman Osborn's a dirtbag, but if Sin Eater wants him, it's got to be for a bigger purpose. And so I can't let that happen. And I also am not the kind of guy that sits back and just lets people kill other people, whether they're Norman Osborn or not. And he's like, so I don't care if Norman's the victim here. I can't let him die. So, it's one of those Spider-Man moments where he's just at the end of the day, just doesn't want any more death. I think he made a promise a couple years ago, like no more death or something like that in one of the comic books. So he's really trying to save every single life that he can, even if it is Norman Osborn's. And that's admirable. Actually, I got to say, that's admirable, and it's very Peter Parker-ish. But also, you know, he struggles with it. So that's very Peter Parker-ish. So which will he choose? Will he choose to save Norman or will he not? Like, it'll be interesting to cross that bridge when we get there, because that book's coming out, you know, like in the next day or two. So I'm excited to see what happens at the end of this. But so after he talks to Miles, he talks to Spider-Gwen also. And he says, you know, like, in my universe, you and I were in love, and you were killed by Norman Osborn. And she's like, yeah, well, in my universe, you know, you died. You were kind of like your own worst enemy in my universe. And she goes, but I'm not the Gwen from this world. And Peter's like, I know, but what do you want me to do? Like, he's like, you're the closest thing I have to ask someone this question. You know, Gwen died, and I want to know if she wants me to get revenge for her. Like, you know, what do you think? And Spider-Gwen's like, it doesn't sound like you. Like, you're supposed to be the best of us. So, like, it doesn't sound like a decision, really. Like, you need to save this guy, even if he's a monster. And he's like, you know what? Maybe I do. So he goes off to Ravencroft near the end of this book with the intention to save Norman Osborn as Sin Eater and all of his minions are descending upon Ravencroft. And then meanwhile, we see Julia Carpenter, the new Madame Web. She's gathered all the spider people, like Spider-Woman, and we have, you know, Miles and Spider-Gwen and stuff, and she's gathered a team who have all been having nightmares, slightly different nightmares, but all the same thing, which is Norman Osborn killing Spider-Man. They're just having these dreams or nightmares that, you know, where the events are slightly different, but the outcome is the same. Norman Osborn kills Spider-Man. So they're like, we need to intervene, because in all of our dreams and nightmares, we all share these visions. Spider-Man's going to die at the hands of Norman Osborn at some point in the future, whether it's near future or far future. Like, our dreams are all different, but it's inevitable. He's going to die, just like he did in the Ultimate Universe. He's going to die, and we need to intervene and do something. So let's, if we let Sin Eater clear out the sins of Norman, then he'll be good, and chances are he won't kill Peter in the future. So then now they have a mission. They have to stop Spider-Man. They have to stop Peter Parker from saving Norman from getting his sins erased. Because, you know, if he gets his sins erased, they think that their visions will go away and that Peter won't get killed in the future by Norman Osborn. And I love that. And that's where kind of this part four ends, is with all the team just sitting there going, we got to stop Spider-Man. And I'm so pumped. So I've already read the one shots. I already know what happens in that. So we'll talk about that, the sins of Norman Osborn. We'll talk about that in the next review that we do regarding Sins Rising. And then we'll talk about the conclusion, because hopefully by then I'll have read it. And, you know, if I think I have a punch card that has $15 store credit. So if I can, I'll run to the comic store this week, you know, in the next day or two when that book comes out. And I'll go and I'll pick up, you know, Sins Rising, the final chapter, whatever it is, issue 850/49. Because if I have $15 credit, because I have no money right now in my account, I have like 12 bucks. And the book, I think, is $10. So I can't buy it digitally like I've been buying the other books. So I'll have to buy a physical copy. But I think I have that gift card in my car. So if so, I'll use that and I'll go get that book. And we'll review The Sins of Norman Osborn and issue 49/850. We'll put both of those together in the next Spider-Man review that we do. But I'm curious, like, you know, have you guys been reading Spider-Man? Are you interested in this? I love what they're doing with Stan Carter and like him being back and him getting right in Spider-Man's face and turning New York against him. I mean, it's pretty neat. I mean, not everybody agrees, because they do a moment where like they interview different people, like Nora Winters is talking to, you know, a medic and a couple other people, like what they think of what's going on. And some agree with Spider-Man that they have to save people. Some agree with Sin Eater that you have to, like, you know, let him do what he wants to do and wipe out everyone's sins. And then now people are volunteering to go to him to be shot, so that way he'll take their sins away, including one hooded figure that we don't really know who they are yet, but I think we'll find out. I think they reveal that in the one shot. So we'll talk more about that in the one shot. But someone who's hooded, who walks up, says, I want my sins taken away too. Please help me. And we don't know who that person is yet. So I'm excited to talk about that in the next episode, along with issue 850 and The Sins of Norman Osborn. It's going to be a blast. So make sure you subscribe so you don't miss out on that. And let me know your comments down below what you thought of this series. I'd love to hear it. And we'll talk more down there. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff. And I'll see you in the future. Peace.